with a hooey or hitting a loo. With a hooey or hitting a loo. It's breakfast with Bob. Breakfast with Bob. Breakfast with Bob.
Honcho Man! So this year, first at 70.3 Monterey, first at 70.3 Palmas, second Ironman Brazil. Mm-hmm. That's huge.
That right? was a good race for me. That was my third Ironman, yeah. And I biked most of it on my own, which for me is new. And
yes.
You know, yeah, I was really happy with my performance there. I was injured leading into the race, so that made it even more satisfying.
Yes.
And to get close to the 8-hour mark is always competitive. I know the courses are never accurate, so
right.
You know, saying it was this time or that time is not always relevant. But no, I was really happy with my performance.
Well, especially
there.
It's a hot race, right?
Yeah,
you're dealing with heat, yeah. And you're going near 8 hours.
Yeah. Yeah,
so
it's
that
a long
gives
time,
you a lot.
Isn't it?
It's a long time, oh, especially
man.
your Olympic stuff.
You can fly to London
stuff.
From Denver from that.
Your Olympic times are like 150,
yeah,
140.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You're like, oh my God, that's
do
a long
that,
time.
Do that, do doping control, have a few beers, press conference pizza, and you've still got 3 hours left.
Joe Skipper, how you doing, Joe?
I'm great, thanks, Bob. Yeah, it's brilliant to be on the show.
Always fun to talk to you, Joe. And what I love is last year you were 13th, and when you look back at it, it was not a good race for you.
No, it was really average race for me. I thought I had an average swim. The bike was average, looking at the numbers, and the run, I just completely melted out there on the Queen K.
And still took 13th.
Yeah, so I've got a lot of confidence going ahead to this year.
Well, and when you got home, you thought maybe your power meter was broken because your wattage was so low.
Yeah, I did. The whole time I was out here, I didn't really hit that many good sessions. Well, to be honest, I think I hit one and that was it. So I thought, oh, the humidity must be playing up my power meter, because I hit some terrible watts in the race as well. And then I got home and it wasn't broken. I was just
you were broken.
Yeah, I was I was broken.
And what happened in the race?
Well, I went and did the race, and I was a little scared. I'm
yeah.
not gonna lie. I mean, I
had had much open water swimming?
Oh, or? None. Really none at all. And I did go and swim once before the race, just at a pool to make sure that I could swim the distance, because I wasn't sure that I could.
And how long was the race?
It was Olympic distance.
Oh my God. So you're talking a mile swim, a 25 mile bike, and a 10K run.
And I really was just so nervous about the swim. I was quite anxious to swim to begin with, and then the fact that I was having to start with, you know, this huge group of people, which I don't even remember how many people were in the age category, but it seemed so big to me in the moment. And so just for me to get through the swim was a big deal. And then I really hated biking. And so I just wanted to get through the bike, because I didn't really enjoy biking at all. And I thought, okay, well, if I can do that and get to the run, I'll be fine, because I really love to run. So, but it turned out to be just such a wonderful experience for me all around.
It.
I mean, I loved, you know, for me, the competitive juices started flowing again. I love just sort of the high that I got from the endorphins of racing. I was really inspired and motivated by just the sense of community and the experience on the whole. And I got bit by the triathlon bug. I mean, in that moment, I finished the race. I stopped smoking. I started working out. I bought a bike. And my life just got transformed.
Well, and before, I mean, it's one thing to say, okay, I'm, this is a great hobby, I'll keep my job, and this is just something I'll do on the weekend. But, you know, by 2011, you're working with Matt Dixon, and you're basically trying to become professional.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't do anything half-assed.
I was going to say, you're not a dip your toe in the water type of, you're sort of the, where's the deep end, and let me jump in.
Yeah, and I think, you know, when I did that first race, obviously I had no experience. I didn't really know a whole lot about the sport.
Right.
But, you know, as a kid, I really wanted to be in the Olympics. That was my dream. That was what I wanted.
Is a runner or skier? Either way.
Both.
Oh, you're going
to
double.
Bo Jackson. One of the first. Yes.
Yes.
I wanted to be the first female to be in both the Summer and Winter Olympics.
That is so cool.
Yeah, and so when I went and did the triathlon, it kind of brought back that dream of mine. And I was, you know, reading all the magazines afterwards and thinking, you know, maybe this is something I could do. So I started training a little bit more, and then I went and did the second race, and I was so much better in the second race. It was kind of at that moment where I felt like, oh, I'm going to go for this. Like, this is, I think I can do this professionally.
You look at, this will be your 10th time racing here. What do you remember about your first time here?
Oh gosh, yeah, my first time was in 2006, and I actually got hit by a car 6 weeks before the race.
Yes.
Yeah, and I broke my collarbone, and I thought, I'm only going to race Kona once. Like, this is it. This is my shot. So if I have to do the swim with one arm, I will.
Yes.
And I came, and I mean, I raced as a pro. I think I finished 20-something.
With a broken...
Yeah, yeah, but my first swim basically was in one the ocean. Arm. Yeah, one arm. And actually, it was weird, too, because that was the year of the earthquake.
Yes.
And it was the first time I'd swam in the ocean. And I went out, and the water was pretty murky. And I couldn't see any fish, and I thought, everyone said there should be fish here and all this stuff. And then I turned around, and the tsunami sirens were going, and everyone was yelling to, like, get out of the water. But the earthquake happened while I was in the ocean. I didn't know. Yeah. It was weird. Like, you didn't, when you're in the ocean, you don't know that an earthquake happened. So that was kind of weird. So that was 2006. So yeah, I thought I'd only come and race once, and then...
And then next thing you know...
Yeah, yeah. They just started stacking up.
So, but then when you came back in 2002... It wasn't about winning.
No.
It was about you loving this island. And I still remember you saying, I'm coming into the Energy Lab. Tim's leading the race. And he sees Peter Reed with a big smile on his face. Not because I'm going to run you down, but he's like, hey, Tim, I'm just so excited to be out here again. And you're thinking, he's got to be really confused by this.
Oh, yeah. He actually told me afterwards. He's, you know, we crossed paths, yeah. And he's like, he thinks he's going to run me down. He's smiling. He knows he's catching me. And meanwhile, I'm like, hey, man, we're racing.
We're having fun. Yeah. You can have the race. Yeah. I'm just excited to be second.
Yeah, exactly. I was excited to be second.
Wins are great, but that was probably a win in your book.
That was a win in my book. Yeah, for sure.
How fun was that? And then you come back next year and win.
Yeah.
Win your third title. And it's one thing to win once, twice. Once you start winning three times, that puts you in very select company. And what did it mean to you to come back and win it? Did it mean more... the 2002 race just to be back enjoying, or did it mean more to win in 2003?
I think 2002 was
more
was
important.
A special race for
yeah.
me. It was I overcame a lot to just to show up on the start line again,
right,
with the headspace to be racing again. 2003 was, you know,
sort of great.
I hit it, like,
yeah,
you know, I was just like, I did my job.
You were back.
Yeah.
You were back working and training.
It wasn't magical. It was, you know, I did my job. I was the best I could be. I tested myself against the best guys in the world, and everything was there. But 2002 was a real, like, big, big turning point for me.
With Ironman 70.3, Wildflower, I think 4 Alcatraz. You've won so many different, the variety of events, Commonwealth Games. What race meant the most to you when you look back at everything? Was it the Ironman win, or was it something else?
I think the Ironman win was huge.
Yeah.
And I say that because I never realized how hard it was going to be. I think coming from ITU distance, you're a little naive. and definitely when I remember my first Ironman, it was actually here. I qualified back then through the 70.3 Worlds.
Yes.
And I think that was 2006, and I was second behind Sam McGlone. And we both qualified, and we're both coached by Cliff at the time, and we're both like going, oh my God, what have we done? And
So the good news is we qualified. The bad news, we got to go do that stupid thing.
Right. So we're literally like, I think it was 2007, we're standing on the start list. That was also Chrissy's debut here too. And it was such an interesting day for all of us. And we're sitting here just going, we're running a marathon today, and we hadn't run that distance
ever.
In training ever. And so it was kind of, there was a little bit of anxiety, but also a little bit of excitement in the air for both of us. And I just remember it hurt like hell. I cried through the marathon. I had never been in so much pain. I mean, I went out racing like I was racing in ITU, like in terms of pacing and also nutrition. I barely ate.
Had a gel.
Just went out, redlined it the whole way, and I got to the marathon, and my legs were totally gone. And I got through the marathon pretty slowly, but I every step hurt. And I guess from there, like, it kind of got better for me. I've heard a lot of people say that your first Ironman is your best one because you are naive, but I'd say that was probably my worst.
September 8th, 2013, your first pro race, right? You win it.
Muskoka, yeah.
Yeah. That all of a sudden changes everything. Your third pro race, St. George, 18th, 10 minutes back. But there was something about that You know, because you're racing against the best guys in the world at that point.
Yeah, well, I had won the Muskoka race, and I sort of thought, all right, I got what it takes to compete on the world scene, you know?
Right.
And that may have been a bit premature, that thought, because then I went to St. George, and, you know, Yanfordino, Sebastian Kienle, all the best guys are there. And, you know, I was a complete non-factor, lost time in every single discipline, and it was just a very, very humbling experience. But, you know, I think the worst part of the experience was I was just so miserable afterwards, like, I didn't want to be around anyone. I didn't want to talk to anyone. You know, I probably was short with my family and stuff. And I came to a few days later, my mom and I were out, you know, running through the beautiful terrain in St. George. And I was like, is this what you become? Like, this is what triathlon has become for you? Like, I got into this to make myself a better person. And now triathlon is making me a worse person. And so it was from that point on, I said, no more of this. I'm not doing it for external reasons. I'm not doing it to try and win the race or whatever. I'm just doing it to push myself to the best of my ability. And if I finish 18th, 10 minutes back, and that's the best I could do, then that's the best I could do. And I'm going to be happy. And I'm going to have a smile on my face and no problems. And it was when I made that change in my orientation that I actually started to excel a lot more.
How long into, you know, getting into the training and racing were you able to look yourself in the mirror? Like you said, even shaving, you had a hard time looking at yourself. Yeah. When did you start to feel good about yourself?
I'd say it took probably about 6 months or so to get, you know, in that time, my body really changed. I think it was about 120 pounds, and I probably got up to like 140 or 150 in those couple of months. So I literally was watching myself transform before my eyes. And yeah, it really was a mental thing for the most part. Once I started to I guess get the shame and that sort of thing of abusing my body and doing all that stuff to myself. Then I was able to look at myself in the mirror better. And but yeah, you know, I mean, triathlon has saved my life, really. So it's something I'm very grateful for.
The cool thing is that your third pro triathlon was at St. George, and then this year you won St. George.
Yeah, that was a very satisfying experience.
And Dad was there, right?
And once again, I went into it with the right attitude. Didn't matter. I could have finished 18th this time, second time round.
But you would have had a smile.
I would have had a smile on my face. And that's what I was most proud of in that race, is it didn't matter. Though I did end up winning the race, and Sebastian Kienle and I had a great race from start to finish.
Yes, you did, yeah.
And of course, those types of races, you know, really, those are the ones you never forget, the ones where you had a great race. It didn't matter. None of that stuff mattered. I had the right attitude. And from then on, you know, I've won every race. Even the ones I've lost, is still won because I've had the right attitude.
Well, and you have won basically all the races. You won Panama 70.3, Oceanside 70.3, Texas 70.3. I mean, you've had, you went, what, 7:58? You've done a lot of great things. But you've been able to stay away from that negative attitude.
Absolutely, yeah. I think that's and the more I do it, the more I realize that the best guys have that type of an attitude. That it's very, very, it's a personal endeavor. It's not for these external goals. Though, generally, when you have that attitude, you can go for good external goals as well. You know, the guys who are winning the big races are doing it because they love it. They love to push themselves to the limit. They love competition, that sort of thing. And it's not for like, oh, I want to finish first place.
Right.
You know, it's not for that sort of stuff. It's just too hard. It's far too, like, you will cower in that Kona heat with 15K to go if you're doing it because, oh, I want to win some money or something like that.
Sixth in Oceanside and second at St. Anthony's. Your first Ironman at Texas.
Yep.
You get fifth.
Yep.
Boulder, 70.3, fourth. Ironman, another Ironman. You get third.
Yeah.
That's a great year. More so, last year you stepped up from Olympic distance to 70.3.
Yep.
And now this year, that wasn't big enough.
One more step.
I mean, that's a big step.
Yeah.
How tough has this been?
Yeah, it's been a really steep progression to transition after racing Olympic distance for so many years.
Yes.
That's really been the bulk of my career. I just did the math, and this is my 18th year as a pro.
Oh, my
God.
So
16 years of racing Olympic distance, and then 1 year of halves, and now I'm doing a little bit of halves and Ironman, and I really, really love the iron distance.
Do you?
I really, really do. I love how raw you are at the finish. That's the best way I can describe it. You feel like you're the most vulnerable version of yourself by the time you get to the finish line.
I love that.
I kind of love the simplicity of that, and I love how connected I feel to everyone out there racing, no matter what point of the run you're in. I love to be able to acknowledge the age groupers and the other pros. We're all fighting the same war, the same battle out there. And so I like that kind of connection I feel with everyone out there doing it.
So when you look back at the transitioning from 70.3 to this, how difficult has that been?
I feel like 70.3s is a different sort of pain, you know. I just go out and race it like I would an Olympic distance race in many regards.
Yes.
You just basically sit, you don't have to think too much, you just race hard. You don't have to nail the hydration and fueling quite the same way. Whereas I feel like with an Ironman, you almost have to feel like the first half of the race that you're going relatively easy. And you let the distance be the punishment, not the intensity.
Oh, interesting.
That's sort of the conclusion I've come to from my limited experience at the distance. But it's all, the pure like distance of the race will wear you down. You don't have to help it by going too hard.
That's a great line. I love that.